In a time of sequels and spin-offs, where many movies have numbers after their titles, Willow is truly one of a kind. With a complex story full of twists and turns and surprises, it couldn't be told on the stage. And with its visual scope and majesty, it couldn't be told on the small screen of television. Willow had to be a movie. Now, see for yourself how an epic is brought to the screen. Willow, the making of an adventure.
Step right up and get your Willow tickets right now. Come on in. You got a little action, you got a little adventure, you got a little magic, you got a couple of chuckles. Come on, folks, bring the whole family.
Grab your popcorn and take an aisle seat as we go behind the scenes of Willow, a fantasy adventure years in the making.
Well, Willow's sort of been in my mind for about 15 years.
We'll watch producer George Lucas join forces with director Ron Howard to make a movie for little people that even big people want to see.
We would say, you know, what would our children think of this? And then, what do we think?
We'll travel to three continents for an exclusive look at the challenges and the thrills.
And then we ended up on the frozen lake at the bottom. I had to do that about 12 times.
We'll take you inside the secret world of Lucasfilm's industrial light and magic, where special effects come to life.
The effects broaden the palette of filmmaking. And this film has a lot of effects in it.
All this coming up as we bring you the story of Willow, a movie with a heart that matches its spectacle.
It's about the least likely hero rising to the occasion and doing something that even he never would have expected he was capable of doing.
Well, I'm interested in fantasy, and in order to make fantasy work, you have to create a kind of immaculate reality that exists for the moment of the movie. And without that, the fantasy won't work.
With that in mind, George Lucas, the creator of Star Wars, recruited Ron Howard, the director of Splash and Cocoon. Together, they would give life to Willow.
When you've got a George Lucas that you can turn to on the set, well, that's an unbelievable luxury, and one that I really tried to take advantage of. And at the same time, George was very respectful of me and from the outset said, you're directing this movie and go do it.
A film that's this big, it's like a Star Wars film. It's really beyond one person's ability to control everything. And so I've sort of been here as a backstop for him to help clean up a lot of the details that, you know, just sort of spill over.
Warwick Davis was cast in the title role of Willow. At 3 feet 4 inches, he played an Ewok in Return of the Jedi. Now just 18 years old, this story is all his.
It's about a farmer, Willow Offgood. Who wants to be a magician. I mean, he's a farmer, but he doesn't like that. He wants to be a sorcerer, to get into magic and everything. And then one day, just by chance, this baby arrives on his doorstep.
A special baby, one who can tip the balance between good and evil.
Have you found the child?
The search goes on, my queen.
Find the child, find the child! Time is running out.
This child must be taken beyond the boundaries of our village, all the way across the great river.
The fates call upon Willow to give the baby to a responsible Daikini, or tall person. Unfortunately, he meets Mad Mardigan.
Give me some water, you measly little pecks!
It's Daikini. We're in luck.
We can't give it to him.
Somebody put him there for a reason.
Well, Mad Mardigan is a warrior on Warrior Skid Row. Being he's swordless and horseless and armyless and castle-less. And he hasn't had a haircut in years.
We gotta give that baby to somebody.
I'm somebody. Let me out of here. I'll take care of the baby.
Little Willow must take the over 6 foot Mad Mardigan up on his offer. They're both giants, however, compared to 2 9-inch wise guys called brownies, who give them a hand and a hard time.
I found a boat. We're all set.
Good. take these two lizards out and drown them.
Lizards? Who are you calling lizards?
Your mother was a lizard.
A frangine is a boisterous, tiny French brownie. He thinks he rules the world. He thinks he's king of the world. Delusions of grandeur, and all his bosses, his loyal friend, rule around.
And I am rule, and I don't believe that the world should be taken so damn seriously.
Obviously spoken by a brownie who has never seen the evil princess, Sorsha.
What are you staring at?
Your leg. I'd like to break it.
You may find that difficult, slave, while I'm up here and you're down there.
I hate that woman.
There's something about Mad Martigan and Willow and the effect of Ellora Dan and the baby that sends her into confusion, and therefore she has this sort of crisis. I mean, she doesn't know whether she's having... What are all these good feelings? What's these feelings of love and everything? And she gets very confused.
I'll kill you!
Death next to love is a trivial thing. Your touch is worth 100,000 deaths.
But Willow isn't just a love story.
What goes on here?
It's also an adventure story. The struggle between good and evil, big and small.
People come in all shapes and sizes in our movie. So one of the things that we were always playing with was that scale and the idea that, I guess in the end, it doesn't really matter how big you are, what size you are. It matters sort of what you're made of and what it is you're trying to accomplish.
Yet, as the producers discovered, the 9-inch actors who played the brownies proved time and again on the set just what they were made of.
Now, I want to complain about our accommodations, if I can right now. Will you look at this? Will you look at this? Thanks for chipping in for the Barbie dream house, George. We're really thrilled with that. Look at the huge openings in there. I feel really secure leaving my valuables upstairs.
1 year ago, the countryside on the outskirts of London was transformed into a Nelwyn village, all built to scale for people under 4 feet tall. It was no easy task finding 225 little people all at the same time.
Getting hold of people was difficult because they're not actors. They don't have answering machines, they don't have agents. They work or they're not at home.
For nearly 7 days, the Nelwyn actors lived together, worked together, and played together. It was one magic week. Capturing that magic challenged the filmmakers.
Why? But I don't want to start it from the beginning again.
You don't want to do the whole thing?
Not really, because, but you still got plenty of dancing, and we can start the music anywhere because it's the same.
Okay.
Or if there's like a halfway point that they can start.
Good job. With the clock running, director Ron Howard was forced to make hundreds of decisions, big and small, each day.
Are they going to be different anyway, so?
Yeah, all right, well, let's just do the whole thing then.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
321, take one, A and B cameras. You got me, Mel?
Yeah.
Slowly through and back again. The frame will come out this afternoon. Okay, very good.
I know a few secrets of the trade now. See, it was really good fun there because I was interested in magic when I was younger and I'd sort of lost interest recently, but now I've brought my interest back again and it was really good fun to learn.
I will now join them before your very eyes.
It really hit me in the Nelwyn village where I was in the minority completely and everything was scaled perfectly to these people that we look upon as being unusual and different. And to see them interacting, performing, working hard, laughing, playing, carrying on, that was, to me, I think maybe the greatest experience in the movie.
The cast and crew also traveled to Snowdonia in a remote section of North Wales. To film the storming of the evil Nockmar Castle required finding 150 horses and another 200 pigs, booking 25 local hotels and hiring 200 local extras, all to accomplish one ugly transformation.
When he goes down on the ground, what happens is you guys begin to see that he's turning into a pig.
What a driveway.
And turn and start to go. And she starts saying, you're all pigs. and starts turning you all into pigs.
You do it by sculpting effectively a different face that is molded in a very, very soft, pliable material. Foam rubber or sometimes plastics are used. And that's literally glued to the skin. On location, we had a great many sort of pull-on masks and suits for all the wide shots, because there's no way you can actually turn 200 people into pigs mechanically at the same time, and it would take years.
While the nighttime shooting in Wales could best be described as surreal, 3 days and two nights spent here in the rain and mist were also physically challenging.
This is wet, this is cold, this is night.
This is Wales.
This is the movies.
Although all exteriors of Knockmar Castle were done in Wales, the interior castle was a set built at Elstree Studios in London. Set construction began 7 months before actual filming.
And action! Cut! I used video assist for the first time, but the kids like in this movie. I'd never, ever done it.
Blocked off there, maybe he'd be less inclined to disappear around that corner.
Well, I didn't even see him. Did he even go out? He was just obliterated by the
people. Show on, he went out after two empty horses, but he dashed around the nearest point of exit, which is around there, I think.
Well, I think maybe he'll do it this time without the other horses. And action!
The complexity of the Willow battle scenes made the video playback an important safety net. At any given time, several different production units were at work. A pickup unit, a second unit, often an effects unit.
I used to joke with George and say, some days I don't feel like I'm the director of this movie. I feel like I'm vice president in charge of cinematic affairs for Lucasfilm.
And in some cases, head of the personnel department when it came to staging scenes between his leading lady and his leading man.
I had a love scene with Joanne Whalley, and it was just very difficult.
And it was quite tough physically to do.
I couldn't remember my lines somehow. Just when I would kiss her and then I would forget what I was going to say, so we had to shoot that over and over again. I never did get it right.
You still have a job to create a character, a believable person.
I don't know. I think it was a personality thing, but we got along all right in the end.
Apparently so. Val Kilmer and co-star Joanne Whalley, who met on the set of Willow, were married last March. The toughest part of the shooting schedule took the cast and crew to Queenstown, New Zealand, a 30-hour flight from London. Filming continued in this mountainous area famous for skiing for 4 long weeks.
We looked in all over Europe, and unfortunately this time of year there's no snow, so we were advised to come here, and this alpine look is just exactly what we wanted. However, having got here and found it, it's now, although a wonderful location, it's very, very hard to get to logistically.
Helicopters were frequently used to ferry cast and crew to the mountaintop sets, together with essential equipment. One night, 4 feet of fresh snow fell and radically changed the schedule. Yet even on normal days, the roads were closed to all but four-wheel drive vehicles. It was here, near the summit of Mount Caldrona, that a snow camp of skin-covered tents was constructed.
The basic problem there was to find a way of holding down the tents in winds gusting up to 100 miles an hour during the prep period, so that we had a set shoot on when the crew turned up.
Certainly, the most spectacular scene filmed here involved an impromptu sled ride taken by Willow and Matt Mardigan.
They did various rigs for this. They had a camera strapped to the front of the sled and a skier towing it down a hill. Started the camera, the guy ran off, and the skier started skiing down the hill. It was a nice shallow gradient, so I was in there just acting away. This is easy. And suddenly it dropped away. It was this really steep slope, and then the acting went, and I was just real fear then, down this drop. And then we ended up on the frozen lake at the bottom. And I had to do that about 12 times. I was a nervous wreck at the end of it. It was so scary.
The making of the film relied heavily on special effects. Hundreds of effects were added long after the film was completed. Other effects are achieved on location. Sometimes filmmakers feel it's easier to control their own bad weather using devices from wind machines to wave makers than to work in the real thing. Other location effects range from adding smoke to enhance a feeling of mystery to using flamethrowers to create a fire-breathing dragon. other effects have to be seen to be believed.
Just come over here for a second. Let me just see if this is going to work.
Action. Death dogs, fearsome, evil, terrifying. And in all close-up scenes, remote-controlled and capable of everything from snarling to bleeding.
Draw back. Okay. Do a snap and then a draw back and then a lunge.
We've also got two Rottweiler dogs trained to wear death dog suits. And that has been very successful, more successful than I ever thought it would be.
Marin County, north of San Francisco, Willow finally came together as the film now seen in theaters. It is the home of Industrial Light and Magic, owned and operated by George Lucas. An unbroken string of Academy Awards for special effects testifies to its excellence.
Special effects never make a movie. I don't make special effects movies. I make movies about people, and in order to tell the story, I have to use special effects in order to create the environments.
The effects broaden the palette of filmmaking. And this film has a lot of effects in it. We're going to be way over 400 effect shots by the time we're done on it.
Dennis Murren supervised the fairy forest sequence in Willow. Central to the sequence is the fairy queen, Sherlindria.
She's sort of a haunting figure. She's sort of a gaseous creature that you could say occasionally appears when necessary in the forest. Because she's out separately against the black, we're photographing her greatly, greatly overexposed. So she's practically like you're looking into the sun. And then we're shooting her in slow motion, so she moves very fluid and magically. And then her costume is very lightweight silks that are being blown by fans hidden all around her. The lights are being dimmed up and down in order to make her a little more difficult to see.
When the crew moved the camera on a crane, Sherlindria, isolated against the black background, appeared to move. ILM could now superimpose her over any background they wished.
How do you know my name?
Elora Denenton. Elora Denon has chosen you to be her guardian.
Me?
Yes. She likes you.
ILM filmed other actresses in the same manner as Sherlindria, turning them into exquisite little fairies.
We don't want you to think of them as neat special effects. We want, hopefully, the audience to feel transported into a time when incredible things happened and were taken absolutely for granted by everyone around them.
Fire-breathing dragons, for example. This two-headed monster is actually a small mechanical puppet operated by a computer.
The monster in this particular sequence has maybe 40 shots that it's going to show up in. The final shots will be a result of hundreds and hundreds of man hours that will probably result in maybe 3 or 4 minutes of screen time in the final film.
Other special effects involve making full-size actors appear tiny. One way to do this is to build huge, oversized sets. In most cases, however, another special effects process known as blue screen is needed. Our interview with the Brownies shows us how this is done. First, the actors were interviewed, literally in front of a blue screen. Then a suitable background was photographed, one that would relate the actors to their environment in an unnatural way. Next, the actors themselves are superimposed over the other scene. The result is the look of tiny people. Unfortunately, no special effects process can improve a bad attitude and a big ego.
Step inside, and then
you'll
see.
You want to step inside? No, I can't. I'm too big. I'm too big to get into little.
All right.
I'm sorry. It's not you. It's everything. I didn't mean to bite your head off.
Willow proves that one committed person can make a difference. And the making of Willow proves that if enough people share a creative passion, they can make a very special movie.
Thanks.
Hey! Keep walking, hero!
Don't even turn around!
It's our show.
I think if you read the script, better yet when you see the film, it's not an argument. The fact that it's called Willow represents the reluctant hero that we guide, save, take care of, babysit. You have to call it Willow because he's the reluctant hero, but quite frankly, you know, it is Rule and Frangine's show.
Yeah, no, Frangine and Rule, actually, technically.
What did I say?
Well,
What did I say?
You said room is right. No, it's very close. Very good. That's all right.
Did I
it's
say
okay.
room?
No, it's cool.
I can't believe
just technically, it should be French right. and rule.
It's an
should.
Alphabetical thing.
Yeah.
That's all.
Well, at this point, it is true. But we're going to cut most of their stuff out. Because we, Ron and I, have the ultimate say. But at this point, we're just letting them think that, you know, it's all their movie and it's about them.
It's far from being the Brownies movie. And I'm just afraid they're going to, you know, sneak into a theater on the opening day and crawl under a seat and peek out there and look and be completely shattered. Because in their minds, you know, it's all them. But, hey, you know, they got to grow up sometime.
No, it's not the Brownies movie. It'd be called The Brownies if it was, wouldn't it? It's called Willow, so it's my movie.
For me, one of the milestones was to do the morphing in Willow.
I'm Willow Upgood.
Willow.
Willow.
Willow. Willow.
Peck, 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 peck.
Transform.
We needed to transform characters one into another, so we created the technique of morphing.
When the movie came out, it got an awful lot of talk about the morphing being something pretty striking.
They've said digital filmmaking is just going to revolutionize everything.
It was really fun and exciting to be part of a breakthrough.
Willow was a huge project. When I read that script, it was just, you know, loaded with all sorts of stuff. It had, you know, giant things and the tiny little brownie characters and all sorts of stuff of every different type of effect you could imagine, the magical stuff going on. It was just a huge undertaking.
In order to make fantasy work, you have to create a kind of immaculate reality that exists for the moment of the movie. And without that, the fantasy won't work.
You're easily shocked. Please turn away.
That's obviously a very integral part of creating these kinds of movies, the fantasy movies.
I think Willow is interesting in the history of effects in films or whatever, that it was sort of approaching the end of the traditional photochemical way of doing effects, but was ready and actually in the area of morphing leapt into the computer graphic world. It was sort of jockeying the two positions, you know, and it was pretty neat. We had been dabbling with computer graphics work here, and we had done the stained glass sequence from Young Sherlock. It seemed so easy to do that work, although it was incredibly hard. The promise was really like, hey, this is going to be great when it finally happens.
When Dennis evaluates a project, he looks at it from the point of view of the filmmaker, of the director, and solves the problem first from a storytelling aspect, and enhanced by the aesthetic, and only finally, how is it going to be done?
There are some examples in Willow of previous technology being applied to the same sort of problem. That's done with building small models and through cables and bladders and wires, being able to make a model pull apart or stretch or contort into another shape. Then you cut away to somebody watching that. And then you cut back again, and you've got a whole new model that's been made, and it goes through another change, as much as you can make, cut away again. What we wanted to do here was do something without cutting away, to show changes and shapes that you've never seen before.
Transform me?
I can't do it. I'm just not a sorcerer.
This was a magical transformation, and Willow was doing it. So you wanted it to be something really special. You wanted to sort of stop everything and just look at it, you know, for a while, because it was supposed to be a real visual, you know, representation of magic.
When we had to approach this transformation scene in Willow, where Willow finally becomes a sorcerer and transforms Roselle through all these various incarnations, you know, I assumed it was going to be sort of your basic clunky, some dissolves, maybe something we could do with a couple of puppets, cutaways to Willow, and I think George did too. But Dennis Muren, he kept coming in and saying, you know, to George and I think there's a thing we can do with computers now, and it might be time to really try to experiment with it. And I don't know whether it's going to work or not, but I can't really articulate it, but you wouldn't need to have so many cutaways. Well, that simply sounded better to me, but I had no idea what he was talking about. And he said, I think we can merge them. And I said, well, you mean like a dissolve? He said, well, no, it won't be dissolved, because a dissolve is transparent. You can see what that is. It'll be, you know, a real blending. You know, the term morph hadn't occurred yet.
I remember we had a meeting sometime in the late summer of 1987. It was Dennis Muren and pretty much the entire computer graphics department of ILM at the time, which was five or six people. Here are the storyboards for what we have to do. How are we going to do that? And we all looked at Dennis and goes, I don't know. Since I was the programmer on the team, I got assigned to figure out how to do the changing of the shapes of the photographed objects so that we could then blend from one into the other. History's a little vague on who actually came up with the term morphing. Dennis Muren may have used that phrase when we were discussing what the program had to do.
The term morphing may have been coined by Doug Smythe. And we spelled it M-O-R-F.
Do we want to call it with an F because that's how it's spelled, or do we want to call it with a P-H so we don't look like we can't spell?
But everybody since has been spelling it M-O-R-P-H.
They didn't really give me any specific instructions for what to do other than this is what the storyboard says has to happen, and this is what we're going to be shooting, you know, these puppets doing these different actions. And you figure out how to make it work in between. I started working on the morphing software, I guess it was like September or so of 87, September, October, somewhere around there. And the first version that actually worked was sometime middle of December or so of 87, when we continued on production of shots until March or so of 88.
Just to get those images in there was a lot of work, because we had to build models that were, you know, controllable, that we could, you know, stretch the neck from one character into another. That was all done by our model shop.
This is the first shot where the goat raises up in the air, and there was a mechanism inside the neck to be able to stretch the neck. This has got no computer work on it. This is the way the actual puppet worked. And there's about six or eight puppeteers working this, pulling the neck up. It was like a giant slinky that could stretch.
There was no other way to do it in those days, except with puppets, because the real animals, you could never quite get to do it. But I suppose if you were doing it now, you could do it all CG. We had to get the tiger here. I was trying to get one of the white tigers from Siegfried and Roy, but there was no way we could get it out here to California to do it, so we got a local tiger instead. You know, we had to get a nice take of that. We had to get a nice take of the woman that sort of matched up with the tiger's motion. And that was the trick behind it all, was that on both sides of the morph, the actions were sort of duplicated by the characters. And then the morph had then less work to do in transforming the one to the other.
This is the very first test we did to sort of prove the system, to try out our input scanner, our output device, our computer, transformation software, and it was real successful to us. We were real happy with it, and it proved that if we do it in one frame, we could certainly do it in a lot of frames.
I think we estimated it's probably roughly around 100 million calculations for one frame, and then when you multiply that by the 24 frames per second that movies run at, you're talking about a couple billion calculations for each second of final footage.
For the frames during which the transformation was occurring, we imagined superimposing a grid on every frame. This grid of points would allow us to establish a correspondence between any two corresponding frames in the before and after sequence, and from one frame to the next. And by carefully adjusting the locations of each point on the images, we're able to tell the computer how we wanted to spatially deform each image. So having computed those two sequences of warped images, we can then mix the two, starting at the beginning of the sequence, mixing mostly ostrich with a very faint amount of turtle, and then proceeding through the sequence, decreasing the amount of ostrich image and increasing the amount of turtle, such that you get what looks to be a transformation of the image. And here's an example of another sequence as we delivered it to optical. This is the transformation from the tiger to Rizal's actual form. One of the things that's really satisfying about this kind of project is that it demonstrates how computer graphics can be integrated with more traditional special effects techniques in the production of feature motion pictures.
Once the negative, the computer graphics, arrived here, we treated it like any other piece of film. We made all our intermediate elements on color film and high contrast black and white, and then ran it through a printer, much like this one behind me, just to blend the background and the foreground of the transformation together so it looked as if it was shot all at one time. The tiger and the tiger's matte pass are shot every other frame, so we loaded up in the printer and set the printer to print one and then skip the other, so we would first photograph the color, then skip over one to the next color frame and the next one. We rewind and using some of the same negative, we shoot the matte pass, one, skip to one, skip to one. This allows us to derive the mattes that we need and the color in order to blend the two of them together into the background.
He does not need to know everything.
I didn't tell him everything.
You told him enough.
My reaction to it when we saw it was, did we do that? I mean, how is that possible? I'd never seen anything like it.
Dennis's first exact reactions, I think they were somewhere along the lines of first, wow, that's really neat, and then second, can you make it do this?
This was probably the first time that real-world objects were manipulated in the computer and then gone back onto film. Nothing like this had ever really been tried that I know of. It had been tried, in the academia world for research, but not necessarily for a motion picture. But because we're set up to do movies here, we had the people and the willpower and the know-how to say, let's try to solve this problem. And we put all the attention to it.
It was really fun and exciting to be part of a breakthrough. I wish I could say it was my brainchild, outside of saying, geez, it's a shame we have to cut away a bunch of times and do those hokey dissolves. That's about all of the authorship that I can claim on that. Dennis was really, provided the vision.
There were these promises the computer graphics were making that were not delivering. And we just had to force the issue if we were going to get it to actually happen, and by sort of pushing this cheapo blue screen through the film formula and seeing its shortcomings, but how fast it was to shoot it, it seemed like, boy, we've got to get it going, somehow so we can really shoot it that fast and get it in the movie, but looking better and easier to get that way, and one of the ways would be digital. So I've all the time been sort of pushing for this stuff to work, because the old effects that we were doing up till then, we'd sort of hit a brick wall. For me, Willow was a unique film because it had a number of wonderful things we could do with it. Great opportunities to do effects in Willow. There were all sorts of different types. It was also very frustrating that we couldn't quite get into the digital and computer graphic world yet. So here's all this work, and if we just could get this working, it could be that much neater and that much better, but we'll do the best we can right now with what we got. And we ended up with morphing, and we ended up with a few things that were sort of showing the future. So you've got both types of work in the film. You've got the best that could be done in the late 1980s, and you've got a preview of what's coming in the 90s.
I did continue working on Morph a little bit after Willow was done. The next version of the software had to handle a few things that were unique to Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. There was a scene near the end that we call Donovan's Destruction, which is where the bad guy ages 800 years right before your eyes. And that was sort of similar to Willow in that there were a number of puppets that were choreographed to go through the same kind of rough motions. And then I would use the morph to transition from the younger head to the medium old head to the skeleton, creepy, dusty, falling down head.
To me, the film that really broke through and delivered on the promise was The Abyss. We had 16 shots, but we actually delivered them on time and on budget, which means you could budget it.
Sweet Christ almighty.
I think it likes you.
And you could actually get it delivered to the movie and when you said you were going to get it to. That was a breakthrough. But then Terminator 2 was the big one.
I proposed the character to him. I told him the sorts of things that I wanted to do, and he said, we can't do that right now. But I think we can get there. And I said, well, that's based on what, tests, software that you're writing? He said, no, it's just a guess, but I think we can get there. I think that's the great moment in the course of any visual effects project where you take that kind of leap of faith that you have a good enough team that allow you to project the trajectory of your technology to the next level.
T2 showed that the future is unlimited. You know, but we were the only ones that knew it. You know, because we could, you know, how we had done it and what we did. Nobody else had a clue as to what was going on.
Get out.
Because that had all digital compositing also, not just rendering, but composite. That was the big film that just changed everything around. Morphing was like talked about like, oh wow, it's really neat. That's amazing. You know, how do you guys do that? And then you didn't see it for a while. And then it was really a couple of years later, 2 or 3 years later, there were some more shows that came out that just spread the word out about morphing, and then everybody wanted morphing. Morphing, if you wanted to do it now, you could buy all the gear off the shelf for your Mac or your PC, and you could pretty much do it. You know, it's not quite as complicated to use as what we had, certainly, but also can't do quite as much, I don't think, now as we could even do. Some areas it's faster, some areas it's not the same as what we had, but you know, to be able to buy it for like $95 or whatever it is and morph to your heart's content is pretty neat.
It oversaturated the market, and then everybody stopped using it and started talking about, well, we'd like an effect kind of like morphing, but not morphing. So there was this backlash quality to it, which was interesting as well.
Most effects, you know, if they're really memorable, you start getting tired of them pretty quick because everybody copies them. There's examples all over the place of that happening. That's why we always have to be a step ahead of the public. And that's why it's so hard doing this work too, because you've got, when you're trying to be on the edge, you've got nowhere to look to find out what hasn't been done.
They are so creative that when you start kicking ideas around with these folks, it's exhilarating, and you come away not feeling burdened, instead, you know, sort of thrilled by what is possible.
For me, Willow was a unique film because it sort of represented very much the end of photochemical era of filmmaking and the beginning and the promise of the beginning of digital.
Willow Ufgood is the hero in Lucasfilm's new adventure.
Elora Devon has chosen you to be her guardian.
He's given a quest to protect and deliver a chosen child in order to fulfill a prophecy.
Where a good king and queen look after
you. You need a warrior.
Producer George Lucas explains the role of special effects in Willow.
I don't make special effects movies, I make movies about people. In order to tell a story, I have to use special effects in order to create the environments. In order to make fantasy work, you have to create a kind of immaculate reality that exists for the moment of the movie.
The evil queen, Bev Morta, changes the good sorceress, Rizel, into an animal. Willow, an aspiring magician, must transform Rozelle back to her real body to aid him in his quest.
We come all this way, and now Elora Gannon's gonna die.
And I'm destroyed.
Elements of eternity, above and below. Balance of essence. Fire begets snow. Lockjaw. Luwafa Danu. Tuwafa Tuwafa. Lockjaw Danalora. Lockjaw Danalora. Luwafa Danu. Tuwafa Danu. Danu. Lockjaw Danalora. Luwafa Danu. Tuwafa Tuwafa. Danu.
Let's go to our earlier mark.
The making of this unique film effect is described by Oscar-winning visual effects supervisor Dennis Muren.
George and Ron, when we were doing Willow, wanted to see a transformation sequence beyond something that had ever been done before.
When your Laura's very special, you have the camera sort of go past her, and you pull back.
The original script told of a fairly simple change. I believe it was from the goat to a deer, maybe to one other thing, to a woman. And that was simply a jump-off point that we could take and do about anything with we wanted. So we were trying for a very startling effect, something that could mainly be done without any cutting. So the audience couldn't tell if there was a cutaway, there was a cheat on it. There's some examples in Willow of previous technology being applied to the same sort of problem. One of them is the muskrat sequence, where we have the little muskrat creature begins growing feathers and starts changing into what you think is a raven, and out pops a raven. That's done with building small models and being able to make a model pull apart or stretch or contort into another shape, then you cut away to somebody watching that. What we wanted to do here was do something without cutting away to show changes in shapes that you'd never seen before. So what we did on the sequence was we built a lot of models and shot characters that were then extracted from the film by a laser and manipulated in a computer and put back on the film again. All the characters you see are shot against blue screen and added later on to the background. So there's puppeteers right around these figures that are holding the figures and manipulating them around. This is the first shot where the goat raises up in the air, and there is a mechanism inside the neck to be able to stretch the neck. This has got no computer work on it. This is the way the actual puppet worked. Next thing then was writing up the software to be able to define the edges of all the different elements that we'd shot, and then to be able to what we called morph the one shape into the other shape. This is the very first test we did to sort of prove the system, to try out our input scanner, our output device, our computer transformation software. And it was real successful to us. We were real happy with it, and it proved that if we do it in one frame, we could certainly do it in a lot of frames.
The breakthrough transformation effect was the result of Industrial Light and Magic's 8-year research and development of laser scanning film into computers for digital image processing. It then took 4 months to write the proprietary software to create this new type of morph effect.
I think we estimated it's probably roughly around 100 million calculations for one frame, and then when you multiply that by the 24 frames per second that movies run at, you're talking about a couple billion calculations for each second of final footage.
For the frames during which the transformation was occurring, we imagined superimposing a grid on every frame. This grid of points would allow us to establish a correspondence between any two corresponding frames in the before and after sequence, and from one frame to the next. And by carefully adjusting the locations of each point on the images, we were able to tell the computer how we wanted to spatially deform each image. So having computed those two sequences of warped images, we can then mix the two, starting at the beginning of the sequence, mixing mostly ostrich with a very faint amount of turtle, and then proceeding through the sequence, decreasing the amount of ostrich image and increasing the amount of turtle, such that you get what looks to be a transformation of the image. And here's an example of another sequence as we delivered it to optical. This is the transformation from the tiger to Rizal's actual form.
I think this sort of transformation is going to have quite a future coming up in other projects we do, because you can do these strange combinations of images that we've only touched on in the sequence.
The making of Rizal's transformation pioneered this remarkable process for creating a new generation of visual effects. Once again, industrial light and magic has made seemingly impossible images which bring fantasy to life.